And it's our honor tonight to host this particular conference. It's an exciting topic, as you well know. And this is on WGBH's Innovation Hub with Karen Miller. And of course, the subject is the new economy and how automation is changing the game, obviously something that's impacting us all today. I'll introduce the panel to you, and then we'll get started right away. First of all, it's Karen Miller, her show, and she's the host and co-producer of Innovation Hub on 89.7 WGBH. And on Innovation Hub examines the future of culture, science, medicine, and more. For those of you who have listened to the show in the past, you know how exciting it can be. The panelists, this is an excellent panel that you've put together. Andrew McAfee, a principal research scientist at MIT, studies the way that information technology affects business. He's the co-author of the e-book, Race Against the Machine, How the Digital Revolution is Accelerating Innovation, Driving Productivity, and Irreversible Transforming Employment in the Economy. Next is Rodney Brooks. He is the Panasonic Professor Emeritus at MIT. He's the co-founder of iRobots in 1990. Currently, he's a full-time Rethink. He is full-time at Rethink Robotics, a company founded in 2008, which aims to change the way robotics are used in the manufacturing environment. Next is Willie Shih. He's the professor of management practice at Harvard University Business School. His interests are in a national competitiveness and capability development by firms in the emerging markets, global sequential production systems, and management of science and technology in intensive businesses. And finally, there's Daniel Thebolt. He did his graduate work at MIT in Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. He developed web-based controlled algorithms for robotic Mars exploration. He is best known as the inventor of the Bear robot, but has since applied his foundational work towards creating some of the most powerful and hard-working robots in the world. Thank you. Welcome, panel.
Thanks very much. Thanks to all of you for coming, and thanks to Suffolk and Sawyer Business School for having us. And I also just want to thank a few people. First, the staff of the Modern Theater, which has been really helpful in putting this all together. I want to thank WGBH and Phil Rado for supporting this idea from the beginning. I want to thank our panelists. This is our first Innovation Hub live and unplugged. And we launched just about a year ago. And when I was thinking about what is the topic going to be, I was thinking about the incredible technology that we've seen, that we've talked about on the show, especially automation and robotics that are changing everything from how airports run to how clothing's manufactured to, if you've been to CVS or Walgreens or the supermarket recently, you'll see a lot of automation in the checkout lines. So, and then I went on a great tour of Vecna with Daniel Thebolt and got to see some of the work in robotics he was doing. And I think unless you work in robotics or unless you work in an industry that is heavily automated or there's a lot of robots, you have very little sense, I think, often, and I did, how much robots touch our lives, the things we're wearing, very often the things we're eating, and how much of a revolution there may be. And then we had Andrew McAfee and his co-author, Eric Brynjolfsson, on the show to talk about their book, Race Against the Machine, which very provocatively talks about both the partnership between humans and machines, but also an increasing competition, labor, skills, speed, precision. So we'll get into both of those things.
If I knew a damn thing about how to sell books, I'd be holding up a copy of it while Kara's talking. But just imagine that it's here.
Yeah. I'm selling it for you.
Thank you.
So you can start to see how these two worlds collide, the sort of the technology, the robotics, the automation, but also the economics, which is going to change our lives, the lives of the people who live around us, that kind of thing. So let's get right into it. So since I referred to you already, let's talk about where you see automation having already taken us, having already changed our lives. And most people don't think about it, but here's one place that you encounter automation all the time.
It's a really great question. And if you look at the history of how human beings have developed automation and what it's done, you come to some pretty extraordinary conclusions. If you try to graph human progress over a long period of time, so if you try to graph just how many people there are, what their state of social development is, what the wages are for workers, what the rates of economic growth are around the world, you come to this weird conclusion that nothing on Earth happened at all until the Industrial Revolution, and then things absolutely took off. So that's the first huge wave of automation that's hit us. There was a second huge wave that kicked off between 1870 and 1900, when we simultaneously invented the internal combustion engine, electrified our homes and factories, and developed indoor plumbing. It's important not to underemphasize that. That was a huge second wave, and now we're in the middle of this big third wave with information technology. So the first conclusion that you draw is that these have been enormously influential and beneficial in human history, especially for us as consumers. The second conclusion is that so far, they have not hurt us as workers or as employees. There has been technological unemployment, but the really wonderful phenomenon is that the waves of workers who got displaced from the farm and from the factory and from being bank tellers have gone on to do other things with their careers. Entrepreneurs and employers have put them to use. And so far, the Luddites, the people who were smashing looms 200 years ago in Britain, those folk have been wrong, and we have not seen any kind of large-scale unemployment as a result of technology. The question that's got me scratching my head really hard these days is that still the case, which is what we'll talk about here tonight? My answer is, I'm not sure, but I don't think so.
So, Ronnie Bricks, let me bring it to you. You probably have the longest history in robotics here. So talk a little bit about what the state of the robotics industry was when you became part of it, and what you've seen change over time.
Industrial robots, the conventional industrial robots in factories were first deployed in 1961, 51 years ago, to a GM plant in New Jersey. I came to the United States in 1977 to work at Stanford, because I got rejected from MIT. At that time, I was interested in mobile robots. At that time, as far as I could tell, there were three mobile robots in the world. Three. Not 3,000, but three. Last year, iRobot, one of the companies I founded, sold 1 million mobile robots. So it's not quite the pickup that's been in PCs and cell phones, but it's certainly a big change in the number of mobile robots that are around. My most recent thing that I'm working on is trying to go back and rethink, hence the name of my company, Rethink Robotics, rethink how industrial robots should operate in factories. And this gets to your point of how it displaces people. Industrial robots, most industrial robots, 70% of industrial robots in factories are in auto plants. They're dangerous. You don't want to be near them. There's cages around them. They're in the body shop where they do welding, and painting shops where they paint parts, and there are no robots in final assembly. It's all people. So there's two parts of the factory, the all robot part and the all people part, and never the twain shall meet. And the all robot part is built by teams of consultants that come down from on high and build these things that have to operate the same for years and years and years, and the workers never have any interaction with them. What we saw 30 years ago was a scene like that with computers. Ordinary people didn't touch computers. It wasn't because the computers were dangerous, like the robots are, it was because people were dangerous because they smoked. and the smoke particles got into the disk drives and crashed the disks. So there were glass walls where ordinary people were on one side, the priesthood of computers were on the other side, and then along came the PC, which brought the PC out into the office, and the ordinary people started using them. It didn't get rid of office workers, but it did change the work that office workers did and changed, you know, over time, changed the ratios, et cetera. So I see the same happening as we get this new sort of industrial robot that ordinary factory workers can interact with and can program.
You talked about iRobot, which you created. How did you come to create something like the Roomba, which many of you know, a vacuum cleaner that was also a robot? How did you decide, let's make a robotic vacuum cleaner?
Because that was business model number 15. The first 14, well, actually it was number 16. Number 15 was robots to clean up, to go into caves for the military to get rid of improvised explosive devices. We'd had 14 failed business models, not because they were necessarily bad business models, but because there weren't customs for them. Business model number 6, by the way, which we got funding from the Japanese government in 1995, was to build robots to go and inspect nuclear power plants. Couldn't sell a single one. March 2011, got a call from the Japanese government, please send some robots to Fukushima. A week after the accident, we sent the robots, other companies did too, from the US, and now iRobot is selling nuclear power plant inspection robots. So how did we get to the Roomba? Desperation. 14 failed business models, one we weren't sure of. Surely this one will work. And, you know, eventually you get lucky.
And here's something that I learned recently on the radio. People make clothes. In fact, there are whole companies, right, that make clothes for Roombas. People name their Roombas and dress them.
We even found one woman who took hers on vacation.
Daniel Theobald, how did you get into robots, and what was the state of the industry like when you first started Vecna?
Well, you know, when I showed up at MIT and took my first class in computer science, there was this demonstration of this really cool robot. It was called Genghis. Rodney Brooks had worked on that, and I thought that was really cool. I'd actually wanted to do robots for a long time, which is why I showed up to MIT in the first place. But I had seen several robotics companies try to be successful and fail. And I wanted to build a company that I knew was going to be around long enough to, you know, get to that 14th or 15th or 16th idea. So we actually started out selling healthcare technology, software, and then automation in the healthcare industry that was not robotic. And then we've taken that over time and turned that into robotic offerings.
And Willie Shih, I know you've looked at factories all over the world. I wonder, are there industries, we're going to talk about industries that will be transformed, are there industries that have already been transformed by robotics and automation? I mean, much in the way that, obviously, the jobs of bank tellers have changed considerably.
Actually, as you look around the world, there are a number of industries that are very heavily into robotics. Semiconductors, flat panel displays, you know, the flat panels in your notebook or your tablet. And those kind of are like Rodney talked about, a lot of the jobs that people can't do because, maybe it's not because they're dangerous, but they require a lot of precision, right? When you're making that display for your iPad, the glass is only 0.3 millimeter thick, you know, and if you let humans handle it, then certainly if you let me handle it, I'll break it, right? But those factories have a lot of mobile robots. They're very extensively automated already.
And to what degree are people part of that? I mean, is it like Rodney was describing, where people are totally segregated from the robots? Are they interacting with them?
Well, you see a range. In a lot of those factories, just like Rodney was talking about, the welding and the painting, right? Those are very segregated. In a lot of the other factories you see, you have a mix where people are working with the robots, and the robots are doing some tasks and people are doing other tasks. But you have a whole range. So it very much depends on the industry.
Andrew, I'm going to put up a picture here of what the assembly line used to look like. And you can see here the cages that Rodney was talking about in the new assembly line. And, you know, when Henry Ford, when the early car manufacturers decided to create assembly lines, it was a partnership of man and machine. And I wonder, is that partnership coming apart? So it's essentially machine and maybe a couple of men or women somewhere doing the direction.
Well, let's be clear. When you found a company, your goal is not to employ a bunch of people. I've rarely heard of that as the founding mission of a company. It's to get into a market and to satisfy a bunch of customers. Historically, we have needed people to help us with that mission. Over time, it's very clear that we need fewer and fewer people to help us with that mission per unit of output. Do I think that's a story about mean, old, terrible bosses? Absolutely not. That's a productivity story. You talk about the manufacturing industry. The trend is amazing in manufacturing. We talk a lot about the crisis in U.S. manufacturing. We need to be super clear. Manufacturing in the U.S. is a large and growing industry in every non-recession year. If you chart the amount of output from U.S. manufacturing, it's huge. China might have overtaken us as the world's biggest manufacturer in the last year or so, but we are right neck and neck, even with that wage differential in China. So that's not the crisis. The crisis, to the extent there is one, is that every year, U.S. manufacturing employs fewer and fewer people in absolute numbers. Now, you can say, wow, that's an outsourcing story. That's because all the labor is going to China. Amazingly enough, every year since 1996, Chinese manufacturing has been employing fewer and fewer people. Yeah. So the trend is a global trend.
One interesting statistic is...
I just gave an interesting statistic.
Yeah.
Which I don't necessarily agree with.
The U.S. and China is about the same, about $2 trillion, yep. But there are 10 times more production workers in China than in the U.S. So an American production worker is 10 times more productive by that measure.
And I also think that what you see in this picture of what Henry Ford set up and with the automated assembly lines with robots for painting and welding is actually a classic substitution of capital for labor, right? And what you find are machines that can do the jobs that are dangerous, right? There were a lot of people who were hurt in the old assembly lines. And by the way, if you go to China today and watch people in the supply chains, there are a lot of people who are hurt, okay? So that type of automation was a substitution of capital for labor, which contributed a great deal to the improvements in productivity in this country. I would argue that a lot of the outsourcing that we have seen has actually been substitution of labor for capital, okay? Because things that were put together in more sophisticated and more highly automated lines in the U.S., when China opened up, the labor cost differential was so high. I had a factory in upstate New York where the labor cost differential was more than 100 to 1, okay? And so the whole mentality was, let's ship it over there and I'll throw labor at the problem.
But this has been a trend. You know, right after the Second World War, the low-cost labor was Japan.
Yes.
And as
Japan stand, first, and then
South
Korea,
then South Korea, then
and Taiwan, and then China,
and then Vietnam,
and then Bangladesh after that.
Yeah.
All right.
So we've seen this movie before. I think the movie we have not seen before is this trend of increasing output with decreasing employment in absolute numbers. That's why I'm a little worried that this time might actually be different. I can't think of an economic law that says that employment has to go up when output goes up. That's been the story so far. Fantastic. I don't have any great confidence that's going to hold true for all time.
Please.
There's an interesting story that Dr. Hoffman works at Vecna. He likes to tell his father when he was young, took him aside and he said, Andreas, when you are older, you're only going to have to work 4 days a week. And your children are only going to have to work 3 days a week. And we could certainly accomplish that technologically. It's the social economic system that doesn't allow for that kind of system.
By the way,
to
how
work.
Many hours a week do you work?
Yeah, exactly.
Let me follow up on the China issue. We're obviously in the middle of a political season. People talk a lot about outsourcing things to China. That's a real label of shame. And we were talking the other day about the Taiwanese company Foxconn, which has gotten so much attention for all sorts of things. A couple of years ago, it was that people were committing suicide. Their workers were committing suicide, so they were putting nets between their buildings so people couldn't jump out. They could jump out the window, but they'd be okay. It also got a lot of attention in the New York Times for, you know, people working on iPhones and iPads and having this metallic dust in their eye, and it was very adverse conditions. Foxconn has just announced, in the not too recent past, that they're going to bring in a ton of robots to replace a bunch of workers.
He announced that at a Worker Appreciation Day.
Yeah, so there you go.
I think there was a little bit of brinkmanship there. He said he was going to have 3 million industrial robots. That is so many more than the total world installed base. It's not clear.
Yeah,
exactly
so
what's
it's,
going on.
It'll
but
be
it's clear that he's having a lot of problems with his workers. There were riots at a factory earlier this week, and doubling the salaries last year.
Well, labor rates in China have been going up 30% a year if you look at all the costs, right? So, you know, it's giving manufacturers over there a lot of pause. But the type of work the Foxconn employees do to put together iPads and iPhones, that's not work that's going to be replaced, I think, by robots very soon. We did an experiment a couple of years ago where we hired some Harvard freshmen who were 19 years old and then had been born in China, raised in China. The requirement was at least the first 10 years of your life, right? And then we took them to a factory in southern China and brought them in through the job fair, and then they were trained for 2 days, and then they went to work on a production line making mobile phones. This particular factory had 15,000 people making 400,000 mobile phone handsets a day. That's a lot, right? I mean, I can't count that many bottle caps, right? But it would be, you know, 7:30 a.m. till 7 p.m., and I'm going to put in these four screws 2,400 times a day. Okay. That type of work, and if you look at how many iPhone 5s were sold in the last weekend, they sold 5 million of them, right? And if you need to ramp up that kind of production over a relatively short time, it's going to be a long time before you're going to get automation to do that.
So what happened with the Harvard students?
Well, it was actually...
Are they still there?
Actually, for them, it was a life-changing experience because therefore the grace of God go I, right? Because it was their age cohort. For me, after 2 days in that factory, we learned a lot of things. It gave us a lot of insight. But one of the things that dawned on me 2 days into the factory, I said, this looks like, from everything I've read, because I wasn't there, I said, this looks like Western Electric, Hawthorne, Illinois, 1925, right? From the way the work was organized. It was a throwback to that era. And
what I say about, and I've spent a lot of time in Chinese factories, building robots in Chinese factories, is that the technique is to break it down into very small units. So the person really only has to do one task, so they can't forget a step.
Right.
And quality control is done by visual inspection. If this step is done, then I do my next step. But you don't have 10 pieces that you have to do, so you might make a mistake.
Right.
Whereas in a Japanese factory or a U.S. factory, individual workers have a much higher cognitive load. They're doing more interesting work.
Right. If you read the history, that was Frederick Taylor, Principles of Scientific Management, which were applied by Henry Ford in the, you know, the 1910s and 1920s. And it's really a throwback.
I get really nervous about predictions like we're not going to automate X anytime soon. There's a wonderful book written in 2004 called The New Division of Labor by two guys who looked extremely hard at this question of what people are good at versus what machines are good at. And they tried to draw some kind of line in the sand and say, okay, the division of labor that we're going to have humans over here, machines over here. Exhibit A for the kind of stuff that a machine was not going to be good at, not just today, but for some time in the future, was driving a car in traffic. I had the chance to ride in the Google driverless car about a month ago down Highway 101 in Northern California. I'm still here. It worked just fine, and it hasn't completely automated the work of driving a car, but within 8 years, it's going to be able to handle everything that, just about everything that we do behind the wheel, and lead to a lot fewer accidents and deaths on U.S. highways, I'm quite confident. So the stuff that machines are never going to be good at seems very clear until they rise up and actually do these kinds of
things.
They
don't rise up.
They rise up. My view of technological progress, especially these last few years when science fiction has become reality, cars are driving themselves. How many of us watched Watson beat the two best human Jeopardy players in history?
Andrew and I had a match between
a
Harvard team and an MIT team and Watson.
Watson beat both of them.
Okay, but the HBS team did better than the MIT team.
Great. So you can be
You're first in the unemployment line.
That's fine. But what I've learned is that technical progress in this era of incredibly fast computers and big data and tons of sensors reminds me of Hemingway's great quote about how a man goes broke. It's gradually and then all at once. And I kind of feel like we're heading into the all at once phase of technological progress.
Can I just quote someone else? Except. It's like a lot of things on the internet, I can't find the original source. But supposedly, Arthur C. Clarke said, people tend to overestimate technology in the short term and underestimate it in the long term. So in the 60s, when computers first came out, there was a big scare that it was going to get rid of everyone's job. It didn't get rid of everyone's job, but you know the thing that was replacing the librarian was this big thing that could answer simple questions. No one predicted that we would be carrying around in our pockets access to all the world's knowledge, you know, in 60 seconds.
Yeah.
No, in that long term.
I think that's fair. And Andrew, I think what you're saying, and I agree with you on this, is that there's a rate of progress which is really quite stunning. And it's, in fact, so high that it's very hard for most individuals to comprehend that. And then you have to overlay on top of that kind of the labor cost, and you know, there's this balance between do I use people or do I use machines? And there's, and I think what we see between the U.S. and China has been a shifting balance in the 1990s and the early part of the 2000s. And now the big question is that balance tilting back, right? And it's driven by the progress as
well. Dan.
Well, and I was going to say, there's another industry here in the U.S. that desperately needs automation, we're seeing, which is the healthcare industry. You look at airlines, banking industry, even retail now. These industries, you could argue, were saved in many ways by automation, by self-service, by the convenience to let people do it for themselves. And in many ways, you'd think offering convenience would maybe be more expensive, but it's one of those really nice things that benefits everybody. I can go and I can get my money out of the bank. I don't have to bother anyone. I can do it day or night. I can deposit my checks now even at the ATM, which is great. And the healthcare industry has been very slow to adopt these type of advances. And so this is one of the things that we've really been working on, is trying to bring some of the self-service, the convenience to engage in the healthcare system without having to spend 10 minutes on the phone trying to book an appointment, waiting for 3 months, then going and sitting for 2 hours. You know, it's very inconvenient right now to get healthcare, and using this type of technology.
And it's not just inconvenient, the quality can suffer. I mean, what's the rate of medication error in US hospitals?
Yeah, and even some surprising things, like just the fact that when I go to the hospital and I register, the nurse is across the table, she's taking my address information and typing in the computer. He or she makes all kinds of mistakes just because they didn't hear what I said. As soon as we put the patient at the kiosk and they're the ones entering their address for themselves, they know when they've got it right. And that one factor alone, surprisingly, pays for self-service in a hospital within 6 months.
Is your sense, working in the industry, when you look at other companies, is your sense that we're in the middle of a revolution in robotics, in automation, that maybe people sort of in the mainstream who are not in the industry don't see coming yet?
Yeah, I think there's an interesting article recently talking about teaching high school students to learn to do things that can't be replaced by, you know, a computer or a robot. But I do see that a lot. You know, we take the QC bot, which is our hospital delivery robot, into a hospital, and people are just absolutely amazed that this thing can actually drive around by itself, avoid people, not run into things, talk to them. And, you know, I think science fiction movies have sort of taught them that this is all science fiction, but it very much is becoming reality now.
Again, I want to say why I think things are taking off so well in robotics, and that is because robotics is able to piggyback off other exponential growths. We know about Moore's law and exponential growth in computation. Computation helps robots immensely. But it's also succeeding because of the lower cost of cameras. The first mobile robot I worked on in Stanford in 1977 had a single $50,000 camera. And we wanted to get stereo vision, so we had drove it mechanically side to side to get two eyes.
Yeah.
A couple of years ago, I saw a webcam on sale for $2.99. So I bought a bunch of them, had the USB port and everything on it. It was a lousy webcam, but it was way better than that $50,000
camera. That's why it was $2.99.
Yeah, but way better than the $50,000 camera from 35 sure. years before.
And the cutting edge sensing technology in robotics research these days is the Microsoft Kinect.
Yes, it's from a game.
It's exactly a consumer device. It costs $150, and it will do depth perception. It has decent quality cameras. It has a microphone array on it. And you can go like this, basically, with a Kinect and get a good 3D map of this room in real time.
And when it gets on the kiosks can be much smarter about their interactions with people. So I'm sure you're doing something.
And I think the Israeli company that created the yeah. Kinect is working on bringing that technology out of video games and into offices, so people will be able to use their hands to direct some of what goes on in offices with screens, with technology. I also wonder, and this can be for anybody, if the choices that we're making, for example, going on Amazon or going, you know, somebody's getting married or something, so you go to Macy's.com, you look at their registry, you pick something, and you hit, you know, you hit send, or you hit purchase. I mean, we're changing the location of what we're doing from stores, where a person would help you pick something out and then package it up for you and then send you home with it, to huge warehouses like those
with robots,
with keyboard and
more all the time.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. And we never see the way that Amazon and UPS and FedEx are. We just know that the book shows up in 2 days on our doorstep. We don't know what's happening. But how much is robotics getting into that kind of retail business?
Big time. And one of the neat tricks in warehouses these days is it's hard even now to get a robot to walk up and down the aisles of a warehouse, go to the right shelf, go to the right, pick out the squishy part or whatever, put it in a box, tape it, and ship it off to you. That's a lot to ask out of a robot. So what they are asking robots to do is literally pick the shelf up, scurry through the warehouse with it, bring it in front of the person who grabs the squishy part out, puts in the box, and tapes it up, and the robot goes, okay, thanks, zips away, and the next one shows up. It's an extremely clever solution to a really, really hard problem. And we're seeing it take off like crazy. Amazon thought it was worth paying $750 million for that technology last year.
Yeah, and it gets back to your point about what people can do and what robots can do. Kiva, which is a company that was here in Massachusetts, decided that the robotic technology was good enough to move the shelves around, wasn't good enough to have that, to reach into the box and get one of the pieces out. But now lots of people are working on that.
Yeah, exactly.
to change, to put more of it to be automated, because it's hard to get people to sit there for hours and hours, pick things out of boxes and put them in other boxes. It's a boring job.
You know how the jobs, have you ever noticed how the jobs that we romanticize are the ones that we just lost? Like, whoever thought that warehouse worker was some kind of fantastic until it goes, well, remember the great days of warehouse work? Gosh.
It turns out the order picking is actually something that is incredibly taxing. A worker who goes to do this warehouse picking, particularly where they're driving a pallet truck, hopping off, grabbing a box, putting it on it, they typically, I think, have a career that lasts about 3 years, and because they get paid by the, essentially by the delivery. And so these are just athletes, and they will just run because they'll make their, you know, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000 that way. But after 3 years, their body's broken. They can't do it anymore.
And there's a Massachusetts company, Symbotic, which is revolutionizing how grocery warehouses are organized. And their robot, I believe, goes something like 25 miles an hour, which, if you have seen the Olympics recently, is about how fast Usain Bolt goes. So, you know, it's hard to compete as a person. You know, I think Usain Bolt would get tired faster, I assume, than the robot.
You know, another interesting point, which kind of reflects that it's not only about labor cost, right? Going back to the example of the ATM machines, right? What's really interesting is if you stand outside these Chinese factories on payday, right? I mean, all their workers get their money deposited to their account, and there are lines outside all the ATM machines. So it's not about labor cost.
So let's look at some of the work that some people on the stage have done. So Rodney, this is your new robot that was just unveiled recently. So tell us a little bit about it and how you got started creating Baxter.
Yeah, this is our new robot, which we just announced Tuesday of last week. It's a human form, clearly. It's got arms. It can reach about as far as human arms can reach, but it doesn't have hips, so the arms are actually longer than human arms. It looks a bit like an Olympic swimmer because of the length of its arms. The key thing about this robot is that, well, there's two key things. One is traditional industrial robots, you can expect to spend 8 months to a year to get integrated into your factory. Our goal with this is 1 hour. 1 hour from bringing the robot to the factory to have it doing useful work. Traditional industrial robots require this priesthood who program it, who understands quaternions and six-dimensional vectors. We started taking this robot to factories and taking people, line workers, who probably hadn't finished high school. We originally used a stopwatch to time how long it took them to learn how to get the robot to do a useful task. We stopped bothering when it was down to a minute and 40 seconds, someone from first seeing the robot to training it to do a useful task. So we've really been trying to make this so that ordinary people can use it, because it gets back to the ATM. If you had to be a specialist to use an ATM, they wouldn't have worked. It had to be someone that everyone could use. So we're trying to make this robot so that everyone can use and everyone can task it, so it's not something that's coming down from above, but small enterprises can build up from below with it.
And my hobby now is to walk around. I got the chance to play with Rodney's robot a couple of weeks ago, and I will vouch that it kind of works as advertised. I was not quite smart enough to program it to do a specific task, so I think my education probably got in my way. But it's a weird experience to grab this robot literally by the wrist, guide it through something, and have it go, oh yeah, I got that. So now
it nods.
It nods, it follows you. It's the user experience is bizarre and not at all off-putting. It kind of welcomes you in and you want to work with Baxter. So now a game that I play is to walk around and see if there's a job that's Baxterizable. I went and got a sandwich today, and in the background there was a woman slicing tomatoes. And I thought, all right. Wait a while.
And the eyes follow you.
Well, the eyes follow you. More important about the eyes is, just as a person who's working, when they're about to reach somewhere, their eyes dart over there before they reach. So Baxter's graphical eyes dart where it's about to reach. So if you're near it, you know what it's about to do. It doesn't surprise you by suddenly the arm moving, because you've got this cue of what it's about to do.
Now, you gave the example of tomatoes. Can you give a couple of examples of small-time businesses where practically Baxter might find a role?
Yeah, a small company that does injection molded plastics. The things pop out of the machine, they fall on a conveyor belt. Baxter picks them up and packs them in a box instead of having a person sit there and do that for hour after hour. Interestingly, a lot of the small companies that we've talked to say there's more work they could bid on, but they don't want to put on a second shift because they don't want people who would do a second shift in their factory at night. So they like the idea of having Baxter as the second shift, can continue to operate and do some tasks, rather, and then they can be more competitive and win more contracts rather than employ more people, which is an interesting perspective. They don't want to employ more people because it's too much effort to get someone they can trust.
But also listen to what Rod is saying. What his prospective customers are not telling him is, oh, great, give me Baxter, and then I can do a one-for-one firing of people for every robot that I bring in. What they're saying instead is, great, I can get more work done with my current workforce if I have a couple of these things and if they work out.
Which is why we wanted the ordinary people to be able to program it, so they were still in the part of the process.
And this is relatively inexpensive, too. I mean, you talked about the Stanford $50,000 robot decades ago.
That was a camera.
A camera decades ago.
Yeah, this is a $22,000 robot.
So coming down the scale. Daniel, I'm going to have you talk a little bit about how did you mentioned bringing robotics into healthcare. Describe a little bit how you see healthcare changing with the advent of robotics.
Well, healthcare is an industry right now that has a lot of challenges. There's actually not enough workers in healthcare, and obviously we've got skyrocketing costs that are a real burden on the country. So one of the things that the industry is now desperately looking for is how can we reduce costs, but obviously without reducing the quality of care. It would be great if we could reduce costs and increase the quality of care. Part of the way that they can do that is by having people shift their attention from a lot of the tasks that are automatable to the things that the robots can't do, which is the human interaction, giving care to that person. Right now, for instance, a tremendous amount of time is spent in hospitals just checking people in. You'll have a clerk behind that desk checking people in, the line's long, everybody's upset, and you don't get the service or attention that you feel you deserve. And particularly when somebody really needs it, it's not there. The check-in kiosk, for example, lets the people who are comfortable with the technology use it, help themselves, they're much happier, and then the people who want the human interaction or need the human interaction can take advantage of that. And we see the exact same thing now with the robot, where the nurse doesn't have to spend her or his time, you know, walking all the way down to the pharmacy now to get the medication. The robot can do that. They can send the robot down, and meanwhile, they can be interacting with people and giving the type of care, the quality of care to the patients that they deserve.
And you brought some robots and are going to show them to us. So I'll let you go and get them out.
So, Kara, this first robot that I'm going to show you is the RPR. RPR stands for Rapid Pallet Moving Robot. This is a robot that would be used in a warehouse to move pallets of goods from one place to another. This is that task I was talking about before where workers would typically have to do this, and it's something that's dangerous. A lot of people get injured and can really be difficult work for somebody. So the RPR robot is able to navigate to, identify, pick up a pallet, and then take it to its destination and drop it off. Why don't you do a little spin for us there, RPR? So this is a heavy-duty robot, but one of the chief concerns is how to make this as safe as possible operating around humans. And so we use a lot of sensors to understand the environment and what's going on around the robot to make sure that it's absolutely safe.
And I should say this is the big unveiling of this robot, of RPR.
The next robot that I want to show you is the QCBot. This is our hospital delivery robot. And one of the things that's unique about this robot is that it has a user interface right on the robot. A lot of the mobile robots that you'll see, RPR included, they don't have any ability for interaction directly with a human being. So one of the nice things about QCBot is rather than having to go find a computer or some kind of mobile device to interact with it, I can just walk right up to it and interact with it, tell it where I want it to go. Got these drawers on the front where you can say, I've got a package for Joe. It says, which drawer do you want to put it in? The drawer will pop out. You can put the package in, close it up. If you want secure chain of custody, you can scan that barcode, make sure that everything is safe. And then it will wander off and find where Joe is and deliver the package to him. This can be used in hospitals for medications, linens, food, take out the trash, any number of things that takes a lot of time. Hospitals tend to be big places, and moving things from one point to the other is big. big time sink, and I think something like 20% of hospital costs actually end up being logistics, which is a somewhat surprising statistic. So both of these robots are focused in the logistics space. How do we move things from point A to point B, getting rid of some of the danger and some of the monotony that human workers have to spend to move things around?
Is QCBot already employed in hospitals, and what has been the reaction?
Yeah, so we are in the process of deploying. We've gotten orders. We've had a number of successful pilots, both in the US and in France. France has actually been a big adopter. And so we are now taking orders, and we've gotten several contracts that are either signed now or very close to being signed. And the reaction has been interesting. Every hospital that we've gone to wants it. But one of the exciting things is that every hospital wants to use it for something different. You know, Dana-Farber's excited about this idea, which I think is really interesting, of actually using the robot to deliver medications directly from the pharmacy straight to the patient, no healthcare worker in the middle. Right now, what happens at Dana-Farber is if you go there for a cancer treatment, you have to sit in a transfusion chair, often for 4 or 5 hours, exhausting, bad experience. And then at the end of that, they often then have to go downstairs to the pharmacy and wait in a line there to get their medications. And so the thought was, maybe we can use the robot to deliver the medication directly to the patient, can present the medication, and then ask the patient if they have any questions. And if they do have questions, then right here on the screen, they can talk to a pharmacist face-to-face, answer any of their questions, has the ability, just like the kiosk actually, to do surveys, ask the patient about their medication compliance, et cetera.
So I assume that this uses Wi-Fi?
Correct,
and
yes.
And this is, I think, is a great example of why things can now be there. If 15 years ago you'd wanted to put this in a hospital, you would have had to say, first install Wi-Fi everywhere in the hospital, then you can have our robot. But it's there, so you can exploit it.
That's
and
absolutely
it's much
correct.
Easier. Lower barrier of
entry. Yeah, and as a matter of fact, one of the big challenges even is your robot driving around a facility, changing from one Wi-Fi network to the other. And now there's solutions for that give a seamless popping from one to the other because of the mobile industry. So lots of examples of technology. Like you said, a very inexpensive webcam on here. We have a Asus PrimeSense Connect sensor on here. So lots of technology that wasn't invented for the robotics industry that we're able to take advantage of.
And this is I think people are familiar with this from airports, really. I mean, this is, in a way, how you check in now very often at the airport, unless you have bags to check.
Yeah, so we got a call, I guess about 10 years ago now, from one of our hospital clients. A lot of what we did was healthcare software system integration. They said, hey, could we do a kiosk like they have at the airport, but for the hospital? We said, sure, we think we could probably do that. So that was the start of this product, and Vecna is now the world leader in patient self-service, and we're just seeing a very rapid adoption of this technology because people are now starting to expect the same kind of convenience that they had in other industries. And as a matter of fact, this is really just one delivery mechanism for that healthcare interaction. You can do it on your mobile phone, on your home computer. You can schedule your appointments. You can interact with your doctor through our secure messaging. Then when you're on your way, you can get on your mobile phone and check in. And then when you get to the hospital, you can do a rapid check-in at the kiosk. Doctors really love this because one of the things they can do is when their patient checks in, that doctor can have a specialized questionnaire for that patient in that condition that they can answer all those questions right here on the kiosk rather than taking valuable time with the doctor to ask those questions. Let the machine ask the questions, let the patient answer the questions, then the doctor can exercise clinical judgment and figure out what to do, what treatment to prescribe. It's just a tremendous time saver.
And finally, the RPR, I mentioned this is its big debut, right?
This is its big debut. It's been a stealth mode project until tonight.
And where do you expect it being deployed? I mean, what kind of situation would somebody want this for?
Yeah, so this goes to what you're talking about. Most of us don't realize where our stuff comes from. This is a pallet jack moving these big pallets around. Pretty much everything we have was on a pallet once, twice, maybe 10 times before getting to us. So this is really how our economy works at a certain level, moving things around on pallets. And it's dangerous work, it's hard work. You know, again, this idea of a pallet picker is somebody who drives one of these around. There's oftentimes an operator standing there. They will drive it around down these large rows. Think of a grocery store, but really big. They'll drive it down these rows, they'll stop it, they'll jump off, they'll go grab a box, oftentimes heavy, put it on there, come back over, climb back on the pallet jack, go to the next one. And they're trying to do this as fast as they can because that's how they make their money. And the number of back injuries and other kind of injuries are just, you know, really unacceptable.
And how much weight can this deal with? I mean, we know, like, as people how much weight we can deal with.
5,000 pounds plus.
Okay, so a little more than I could lift, maybe. Yeah,
a little bit more. But again, I think, you know, safety is a real key for robots. And, you know, Rodney's done a great job of addressing that to make sure that the robot doesn't have to have a cage around it. That's the point. We need to be able to work with the robots. We can't cordon them off to a separate part of the work environment.
Are we hollowing out the middle of jobs, right? No more jobs for the bank tellers. We saw matter of a few weeks ago, this is the very end of August, that there are new jobs. It's not like new jobs aren't being created, but they are mostly low-wage jobs. And Andrew, you've written about this. There are certain things that we have not figured out how to be very good at with robots. Busboys, masseuses, nannies, they're not robotic yet, although they're not very well-paying jobs either.
Yeah, the data are just extraordinarily clear. We are people at the very high end of the education and the skill range right now doing pretty well. People at the absolute low end certainly not doing as well. In fact, as you say, these are not great jobs, but they're relatively stable jobs because they're doing things that computers and robots are not yet good at. This big group of people in the middle, the classic American middle class, is under a lot of strain these days. They're moving backward in some pretty important areas like household wealth and annual income. The job growth is lousy in these areas. We just can't pretend that this stuff is not going on anymore. We can't pretend that it's not a big deal. My crystal ball is cloudy about this. The future is always just incredibly hard to predict. One thing I am pretty sure about is that this polarization is likely to accelerate instead of reverse course, despite the fact that I agree with Rod and our other panelists that the technologies we're talking about are not going to directly displace and put thousands of people out of work, but this technology trend that we're talking about is part of the story of the backward movement of the American middle class and the large and growing inequality and polarization in the economy.
Well, and McDonald's, I think, is going to be automated. It's not too far in the future. It's going to be a big vending machine. Yeah. I mean, you know, we have to be realistic about that.
We've already seen, for example, some evil geniuses who watched what a really good barista does to make a cup of espresso and automate that. I have not tried this. I hear there is a box where you walk up, type in your pizza order, and 20 minutes, a fresh, fresh hot pizza comes out. So yeah, we're automating
tea,
these things.
Earl Grey.
I mean, Willie, no, you know, when you think back to that picture of the Henry Ford line, I mean, nobody said, look, we should stop with the technology because they're people, and these are good, hardworking people who build horses and buggies. And I mean, it is not reasonable to throw them out of work. But are we at that kind of inflection moment where you have to find new jobs for these people to do? William, then
I think it's a very difficult question, as Andrew has said. It says that the requirements for manufacturing jobs, the skill level, the requirement to constantly refresh your skills and kind of renew them, that bar is going to be going up, and it's continuing to go up. It has gone up over history. We've seen that in the factories of today. The same thing is going to happen in China as well. And there's a huge wave of capital investment going on in China where they're bringing in more sophisticated production equipment. And a lot of those Henry Ford type jobs are going away as well. And so that says it's really incumbent on the workers to keep their skills growing.
I want to be at variance with you a little bit on that. We have seen that all of us, are able to use these devices. Actually, the people who make $25,000 a year don't have these smartphones because it consumes too much of their income. But the people, you know, even at the lowest social levels in India, use cell phones. And why can they use them? It's not because they had to be smart enough to, you know, this has Unix in it, but you don't have to type Unix commands in order to use it. It was because the interfaces were made so that people could adapt to them. Now, the factory worker of today is not the factory worker of 30 years ago in that they're used to using menus and things like that. But if we apply the information technology to make things easier to use, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to get smarter and smarter at a very high rate to use more sophisticated technology. One of my favorite examples of this happened at iRobot, another company that I was founder of. We had lots of robots in Iraq and still have lots of robots in Afghanistan that are used for bomb disposal, for IED disposal. The main competitor that also sends robots to Iraq and Afghanistan is another Massachusetts company, formerly known as Foster Miller, now Kinetic. Their robots were nowhere near as good as ours. And they were just crude. But we start hearing word back that our user interface, iRobot's user interface, had a problem, and the technical term for it was that it sucked. And the MIT-trained engineers at iRobot were outraged. But it's got menus, and you can do anything you want with it. And then one unnamed iRobot engineer, Pavlo Rudicevic, said, well, we need smarter users then. You know, we need to have better trained soldiers out there, even though they had training. That wasn't the right solution. Those 19-year-old kids were out there with bullets going by them, trying to use this robot with an engineer-designed UI where you could do anything with the robot that it was capable of. The solution was to put a game controller on the robot. Zero training, 5 minutes of practice, 85% of the capability of the robot. Could they get to 100% of the capability of the robot? No. But they never got to 85% with the complex interface. So it was matching, using information technology to match to the capabilities.
So I agree with you, but that requires people to improve the user interface and improve the usability. Okay, but
and the game industry is making that happen.
The game industry has made that happen, and the U.S. military has exploited that to great benefit. Okay, but I think there are still a lot of jobs out there where, you know, traditionally manufacturing has been the route to the middle class for those who are in the middle, maybe have had less education, but now on a factory floor, increasingly, as you replace a simple task, there's much more knowledge work involved. You have to be able to work on improving processes.
You better be good at problem solving. You better be good at working in teams. You'd better be a very effective communicator. These are not the skills that a lot of people are comfortable with. They're not the skills that our education system does a great job with. And a lot of our jobs right now seem to have been designed to very accurately follow instructions over and over again. But we don't need many of those.
But I think there's an attitude of the people who supply the tools, which I was in Sweden with a major industrial robot manufacturer a few months ago, and I was talking to this guy and saying that I thought it was important to make industrial machines easier to use. But machines are complicated. We need smarter users. Same comment. His self-worth was how complex the process was and not how easy it was to use. And other industries, you know, people who sell your stuff on the web at the airport have been driven to make it simple to use. And
absolutely.
The same, I'm sure, is used in the healthcare, that making it easy to use so that everyone can use it. You can't say, we're going to make healthcare good, but only for the people who are very sophisticated.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, one of the things that Vecna has been doing since the beginning is we will donate 10% of our work time to community service around the world. We are deploying our healthcare technology, our kiosk technology, throughout Africa. And that was exactly the key. What we made was an electronic medical record that was so easy that somebody with not only no computer training, but somebody who had never seen a computer before, and then I'm talking about out in the bush, a little one-room clinic, no running water, nothing. We bring this electronic medical record system, solar panel pops out, And they're able to use it literally in a matter of minutes. We have to teach them what a touch screen is and how they touch it to answer the questions. But then they get it. And so one of the really exciting things is now we're seeing hospitals in the U.S., Worcester Free Clinic, for instance, saying, wow, we need that here in the U.S. as well, because our electronic medical record systems are way too complicated right now.
Let me come back to something that Andrew mentioned before, the sort of idea of inequality potentially. And this is just a graph of the Dow Jones. You can see it's bottoming out there in March of 2009 at about 6,500. As of today, it's well over 13,000. Now, we don't think of ourselves as in a great and stellar recovery, but if that's where all your money is, that's pretty good. This is the civilian unemployment rate. And you can see it since 2009, and right now the three lines are simply on the bottom. The red line is the stated unemployment rate as measured by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. Then above it is those people plus the people who are discouraged and have dropped out. And then the top one is those people plus people who have what they determine to be marginal employment, so incredibly sort of a small amount of employment. So I wonder, Andrew, have we not seen yet either people climb up that education ladder? Because the issue doesn't seem to be that we aren't producing things.
No,
or making money.
Yeah, the juxtaposition of these two graphs is really interesting. By some measures, things are actually on a pretty decent track. If you have capital, if you're an investor, life has been pretty good for you, as you just showed. U.S. investment in equipment, in gear for our factories, thanks to guys like these, is at an all-time high, higher than it was before the Great Recession started. Our GDP is higher than it was before the Great Recession started. If you look at the percent of working-age people who have work in America, it cratered during the Great Recession. It has not recovered at all. Those lines have absolutely flatlined. So by some measures, our economy is not roaring along, but it is absolutely coming back. The employment situation is not coming back. And the phenomenon that I'm most worried about, and there are lots of different labels. There's the lack of mobility, there's the inequality, there's the polarization. My favorite word these days, it's too common a word, is the economic precariousness for a lot of Americans is just extraordinarily high, especially when you take into account that most of us get our health care, and therefore a lot of our health, via having a good old-fashioned industrial-age job at exactly the time those jobs seem to be getting more scarce. So there's great news out there, but again, when we look at the classic American job, the classic American worker, there's just a lot more precariousness and times are a lot tougher out there. I don't want to excuse technology from that story. Technology is part of that story, while at the same time, it has brought a huge amount of benefit to that worker as well.
And Daniel, you and I have talked before about there being a real premium, if we sort of go back here, there being a real premium on the people who can program, who are sort of the real creme de la creme and can create the kinds of things we've been talking about tonight. And I wonder if that creates somewhat of a divide, if the jobs are being taken away in the middle, like the Henry Ford assembly line.
Yeah, it's a really interesting phenomenon. But what we found was that there is a very non-linear relationship between productivity and talent. So a really talented engineer produces about 10 times the value of a good engineer, who produces about 10 times the value of an average engineer. And that 100 times difference sounds unbelievable, but it's absolutely true and can be backed up by data again and again. And part of the reason that happens is because there's this time aspect to any project. You know, if you just had a short task, well, the good engineer is not going to maybe do much better than the average engineer. But now when you have this compounding effect of the decision I make now is going to affect the decisions I make 10 minutes from now, 2 weeks from now, the product support that we have to do later on because we made some bad architectural decisions, you know, so our strategy has been, let's hire the absolute most talented people we can find in the world because we can't afford to hire people who are going to make the mistakes that require us to hire a lot more people who are going to make mistakes. It's a little bit of a negative view on it, but the positive side is when you find people who really know what they're doing, they can do an incredible amount of work and provide a tremendous amount of value. Now, our educational system isn't producing a whole lot of those people right now. And that's one of the real challenges I think we have as well with this idea of the type of jobs changing. We haven't figured out how to produce the type of people that are going to fill the type of jobs that maybe it's changing to.
And Tom Friedman has written about this, the idea that average is over, which is sort of what you're talking about, that being average may not be good enough.
And to that point, I heard a great nasty quote the other day. Someone said, we're heading into an economy where there are two kinds of worker, those who tell machines what to do and those who do what machines tell them.
And I wonder, the Hoffman vision of spreading the work around a little more evenly so that we all have more leisure time. Yeah, I mean, I often spend 60 hours working a week, sometimes more. There are people who would love to have a few hours of work a week. You know, it somehow doesn't work. And is there any chance of us getting to something like that? I have no idea. It's a really tough problem.
Let me bring in some questions from the audience. Here's the first one. When do you think household robots will prevail? Say, robots that can clean, cook, organize, etc. Rod, you want to take that?
Well, when we started doing the Roomba...
This is a movie that's out now, and the idea is sort of helping around the house. So when is this going to be a reality?
When we started doing the Roomba, and I use this technique now for lots of things, I said, can you imagine that in 50 years your vacuum cleaner won't be robotic? And they said, no, of course in 50 years it's going to be robotic. So then I said, well, if it's 50 years, what about 49 years? And then I got people to agree that vacuum cleaners were going to become robots. It was just a matter of when, and when should we start doing it. So can you imagine that, what was the list of tasks?
Cooking, cleaning, organizing.
Yeah, exactly, cooking, cleaning, that's right.
Yeah, so I can't imagine that most of those tasks won't be done robotically in some way, but they may be done in very different ways, because cooking is done robotically for us in a sense, and a lot of stuff is pre-processed, but people want to have a little bit of creativity in the final product.
Or how about your KitchenAid? Would you describe that as you're kind of getting help from a machine?
You are getting help from a machine, but maybe the thing that cleans up the dishes and puts them in the dishwasher will be very different. Maybe the dining room table will be the dishwasher, and so you eat at the dining room table, and then the plates is cold inside. And they get washed and they spring out clean again.
Okay, another question. Taking the human-robot interaction to the extreme, I wonder what the panelists think about cybernetic enhancements to people or if that'll ever take place.
It's already taking place.
I mean, have any of us seen the video of someone having their cochlear implant turned on for the first time? It's hanky time when that happens. We are giving people the ability to hear that they lost a long time ago. It's very feasible. We're going to be doing the same thing with vision, Rod, 5, 10 years from now?
Well, there's clinical trials happening now for blind people with macular degeneration with retinal implants.
Now,
yeah, we won't need those iPhones in the future, right? I mean, it's going to be right in your head. That's
Google's
scary thought.
Already well, that's, working on
it. That's the interesting part, you see. Plastic surgery was originally to repair people who had severe burns. That's not what plastic surgery is used for now. It's an optional thing. You use it to improve yourself. If I could get an implant which would have an internet connection in my head, I would take it today. I would prefer to have that. As these enhancements come for retinal implants, maybe people with good sight will want a retinal implant so they've got infrared vision. We saw some of this happening in the Olympics, that there was a question, is the guy with the metal feet, is he getting an unfair advantage because he doesn't have regular legs? I think that we're going to have enhancements all over the place. And if I was selling a book, I would have my book, Flesh and Machines, here, which is actually 10 years old, which talks about these issues.
Rod's moved up to somewhat higher price points with the products he sells than a book.
We touched on this a little bit before, but I'm sure this is a concern that comes from a lot of people. What can people do to ensure that their jobs and skills stay relevant? And you talked about Watson before, who beat Ken Jennings and Brad Rutter on Jeopardy. A lot of people think Watson was connected to the internet. He was not. right? He had all that knowledge inside himself. He could understand. If you think about Jeopardy, the questions are asked in kind of a weird way, right? A specific person asks them, so you have to kind of understand how he talks. So what do people do to make sure that their jobs do not get taken over by increasingly smart computers?
Yeah, it's a brutally hard question, because 6 years ago I would have said, ha ha, learn to drive a truck, you'll have a job forever. No, absolutely not. So that line is really, really fuzzy. So I've learned never to say never, but there are still some things I've never seen digital technologies do. I've never seen an entrepreneurial computer. I've never seen a creative one. I've never seen one that had any aesthetic sense. I still haven't seen one that could write a long piece of prose, synthesizing a bunch of information and doing it well. By the way, we have seen algorithms that can write short prose and do it quite well. So we're inching away at that. And then down at the low end, I think busboy, if that's what your ambition, that's a profession that's really not going anywhere for a long time, because it's extraordinarily hard to get a robot to do everything a busboy does.
But I think there's a little bit of there's always been these questions with all technologies. This is not new. This discussion happened around the Gutenberg press. What will happen to the scribes who copy books?
Happened in agriculture.
And now that those jobs that were taken away from agriculture, working the machines, the only people who do them are the non-documented immigrants. No American who's documented wants to do those jobs. So we're sort of romanticizing that these jobs are going away and that jobs will go away. But the history tells us we always change what we do, we adapt, we integrate ourselves with the technology, and we do different things.
You're right, and the history shows us that we re-employ people who have been unemployed by ways of technology. I just have less confidence in that argument from history when
because
I watch...
Because you're special, and this time, when you're alive.
Yeah, exactly. So I've got... But you tell me, has a computer ever beaten the best human Jeopardy players? That is an extraordinarily good knowledge worker right there. He's out of a job.
People still play chess.
Not competitively, they don't. Not if you want to be
yes,
the best
they do.
At it.
People do play chess.
They asked a chess grandmaster a little while back how he would prepare for a match against a computer. He said, I'd bring a hammer.
Well, and the busboy, I don't know how far off that is. I mean, we're working on the being able to pick things up. One of the biggest challenges in mobile robots has been energy density, how much energy can I carry in my batteries, and power density, right? Hollywood has given us this vision of robots that can run, jump, outperform humans. And I used to think that was never going to happen. We're actually working on a really exciting DARPA-funded technology that has 10 times the power density of any other known practical actuator, while several times the energy efficiency. And so a lot of these things that we thought, you know, just weren't going to happen in terms of mobile robots, I think we're going to start seeing some humanoid robots that can actually start to perform comparably to human. Now, the intelligence piece, you know, we've got a lot of, this kind of intelligence, but physical intelligence is a completely different thing, but that will come.
So if your ambition is busboy, have a plan B. Is what you're saying. Okay. This person obviously is well-versed in party games, and they want you all to complete this sentence. Human beings are the only animal that can...
Love?
Feel emotion?
Worry about the jobs being taken away.
You didn't want to add anything? Oh,
that's actually a great sentence. Dan Gilbert, who wrote the great book Stumbling Into Happiness, has looked across his discipline and says, man, every cognitive psychologist, every anthropologist has written that sentence, the human being is the only animal that can blank. And he agrees with Rod's answer. The human being appears to be the only animal that can think about and worry about its future.
To Daniel, how's a robot's bedside manner?
Well, I think this is one of the things that we find that people who want to interact with a human, you know, should and oftentimes have that opportunity. But so many of us want to just get things done. And if you do want that human touch, the human can either be there in person or can come up through the telepresence system. Yeah.
Sometimes you don't want that human touch. I went to Australia earlier this month to visit my mother, who's in managed care. And she has two people who come in and put her to bed with a crane every night. She would much prefer to have some machine to do that. She has a person who washes her in the shower. She would much prefer not to be naked in front of a person to do that. She would much prefer to have a technological solution. So sometimes the technological solution is better, which is, you know, I think given a choice, most people go to the ATM rather than the bank teller because it's just easier to deal with the ATM than the bank teller.
I like self-service gas, right? No human interaction.
It's so easy to romanticize the human touch, and believe me, good interactions with people in our professional lives are invaluable, and these people should be super well compensated. But how many of us have dealt with apathetic, undertrained, couldn't care less, you know, wage slaves of one kind or another while we're trying to go through our day or trying to get our work done? I want that human touch to be replaced, quite frankly.
Say, this is the PR2 robot that is now open source, so people are working on having it do different things. It can so far pick up cans, play pool very well, by the way. I watched a video of it playing pool. There it is, playing pool. But, you know, we talk about, oh, well, there's certain things robots can't do. When you might want to wait on that. Yeah, so let me ask one last question here that somebody asked. How should we be training average U.S. first graders to compete with or at least work cooperatively with robots when they join the workforce? How do you bring robots either into education or teach people to just to have jobs that are not going to be taken away by robots?
Well, I think one thing is that we need to start an engineering curriculum much earlier on. My daughter, for instance, is just entering high school, and one of the things she wants more than anything is to really get into something that's actually creative and making something. She's taking a pottery class, which is great and artistic, but you know, teaching people how to think about solving tough problems very early on, I think, is very, very important. And we probably don't do as good a job of that as we could right now.
I think we need to teach people when they're young to learn how to learn and have a continual thirst for learning, right? Because I think particularly what Andrew has been talking about and how the capabilities of machines keeps going up, right? And, you know, his book title is actually great. It's a race, right? I do think it is a race. But humans are still the most flexible. You know, I've thought about this as I walk through factories. You know, when you really need flexibility, you use humans. But, you know, that is a race, and the simpler tasks will get automated. And you'll have to improve the humans will have to improve their user interface as well in terms of being pleasant to interact with, right? So that they can get those busboy jobs and things. But, you know, being able to continually learn and keep pace with these things that are coming, I think is really important.
I think this is a really important question because, you know, there's sort of a fatalism about technology sometimes. It's just going to happen and you're going to have to deal with it. But I do think that we have the opportunity to think about the type of society we would like to have and work towards that. And I think that we have a lot more power individually than we think we do. You know, one person, one idea can really make a big difference. And so I think we can't just surrender to this idea of what's going to happen happens and we're going to have to deal with it. We should really spend time as engineers, as scientists, as everybody thinking about how would we like to use this incredible opportunity we have, and what are we going to do with it?
And I'd just like to follow up on that. I think there's an incredible empowerment from these technologies. The maker movement is one, where people can build more stuff. Tech shop, there's a version of that in Somerville, where people can get out and do stuff with CAD tools, with off-the-shelf technology and building. So what's the best preparation in first grade? Less structured time, more Lego.
I couldn't possibly agree with my fellow panelists more. Little kids just want to learn, and they want to go explore the world. And I was a Montessori kid for the first years of my education. And the philosophy just does this brilliant job of teaching little kids that the world is an interesting place, and your job is to go out there and maybe try to figure it out or get your hands around it and do stuff. The Montessori where I was stopped in third grade. So starting in fourth grade, I went into my town's public school system, and I thought someone was playing a joke on me, because they're like, we want you to sit in this seat, in this grid, all day long, and we're going to do math for 50 minutes, and then something else, and then English. And I'm like, am I in the gulag? What the hell is happening here? And just trying to get out of that
mode. And in third grade, you knew what a gulag was,
yeah,
what you're saying.
Yeah. And my teacher didn't, and I thought that was part of the problem that we had.
Well,
I went to Montessori too, which could explain a lot of this.
This is absolutely right, though, because right now what our schools teach kids is you've got to get as far away from a school as possible.
Yeah.
It's not fun. It's not pleasant. I don't want to be there. Learning is bad. And
how many of us have wonderful memories of our primary school education? Seriously? Have wonderful memories of our primary school education. How many of us were bored a lot of the time and kind of sat there and just dealt with it? Yeah, come on, we can do better than that.
Any more comments on this? This has been a great discussion. I want to thank all of you for coming out, and I want to thank Daniel and the engineers who helped and brought the robots, and Willie Shee and Rodney Brooks and Andrew McAfee. Thank you so much.
Kara, thanks very much.
Thank you.
And we will probably bring this screen up and bring up the light, so if you want to get a little closer to the robots for a second, you can.
So, I mean, it's like any other gamepad. Basically, you use a joystick, and that essentially tells it how quickly you want it to move and what angle you want the wheel to be at as it's moving. And then you can use the triggers to essentially set how fast you want it to go.
It's the now humanoid robot by Aldebaran Robotics, and it's a humanoid robot with 25 degrees of freedom, and it has two cameras, touch sensors, inertial sensors, infrared sensors, speakers, all sorts of stuff, lots of motors. It's mainly used in the education market. It gives students programming knowledge. The core thing is this is a platform that it's pre-made. It's a robot that you get that you can just start programming. A lot of other robots, you have to build a system at first, and it's really difficult if you're not an engineering student. So. Yeah, we have a really good interface. It's a drag and drop interface, and you can double click and get into the code. But if you just want to make it walk and talk, you can just connect to it and drag and drop. Presentation. So it's kind of loud in here as well.
Presentation.
So.
I love talking about me.
We'll give up.
I will try not to take too much time, but there would be so much to say.
Predictions and ideas about how this is all going to work out. We're saying,
we don't want to capture 3% of the market. We're going to be millionaires.
And yeah, it's just too many assumptions.